Epic fail, right? Epic fail. I was standing back there and I was watching that video laughing and I realized, wait a minute, I got to get up and speak. What am I doing? It's good to have PJ in the house. That's part of the reason why I should have been staying back there. I thought he was getting up here. I was ready to sit down and just listen, right? Get challenged to walk with the Lord. When he told me that this week, we had dinner together. He told me about getting asked to leave out of a church, and it angers me, if I'm honest with you. It angers me.
They didn't know I was a pastor.
That doesn't matter. That doesn't matter. I'm just gonna ask you something. My season here with you is only so long, obviously. You guys understand that. But I'm gonna ask you a favor from me, okay? This is from me. This isn't Big House, this isn't PJ, this isn't anything else. Don't ever do that. Amen. Let everybody feel welcome here. Amen. Let everybody feel welcome. I'm telling you, I've sat in his shoes. I've never been asked to leave before, but I've been in places where I sat there and it was fine. The worship was good. The preaching was fine. There was nothing wrong with it. But I sat there basically in utter isolation in the middle of a room full of people. And no one came up and said, hey, so glad you're here. No one gave me a hug, shook my hand. I walked in and walked out, and no one was the wiser that I was there. Right? I don't know if you've ever been there, but that isn't the God that I serve. That isn't the kind of church I want to be a part of. That isn't the type of Christianity that I want to follow recklessly. Be different. Be different. Love on people. You don't know. I am constantly amazed, and this is completely outside of anything that I was planning on talking about, but I am constantly amazed at the stories I hear from people. If I just take a minute to say, how's it going? And this is the typical answer I get, right? Oh, that's all good. And then I look them in the eye and I say, how's it really going? The stories that you get, you just do not know. It doesn't matter how good they look, what kind of car they drive, what kind of car they don't drive. The stories that you get, if you care about people, will show you that everybody's hurting. And everybody needs somebody to come alongside them from time to time. Big House. You are that way. Never change, okay? Never change. We are week 7. Can you believe it? You guys have put up with me for 7 weeks. Yeah. I wouldn't be applauding, but I appreciate it nonetheless. I mean, it's just the way it is, man. I'm just one guy, man. I'm thrilled to be here with you. Thrilled to be here with you. But what matters most to me, what matters most to PJ, I can tell you this for a fact because I know his heart, is not about what you do and if you tell me I did a good job or even if you come down to this altar. What matters to us is how you live when you leave these walls. If you live the way that God wants you to live outside of here, everything else will take care of itself. Amen. Right? Whoa, I about knocked that over. That would have been bad. So what did you guys think about epic fail? Oh. Epic fail. That was epic fail. Unfortunately, I've been that guy a few times when I was a kid, that karate guy. It's kind of like this, like, bad. Nothing but bad comes from those kind of videos. I'm just telling you. The reason I showed you is because we're talking about power this week, and that is the opposite of power, right? Opposite of power. Failing. Falling on your face. But there's something intrinsically tied between failing and winning. I don't know if you realize that or not. You got to give it a go to know if you're going to fail or win. You got to give it a go. You got to get out of the gates. And so I felt like it was only right to start with failures before we started talking about how God's empowered you to do something good. So here's our verse. If you remember it, say it with me. I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. My God, my rock, in whom I take refuge. My shield and the horn of my salvation. My stronghold. I call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. And I am saved from my enemies. The horn of my salvation. This is why you read this. And I'm just going to tell you this. It can be translated power. Horns were significant throughout the Bible. I don't know if you realize that or not. Blow the horn unto Zion, and there's all sorts of scriptural references to what horns were, but they're not trumpets like what you most people think of. We're talking about a shofar, something big, as a long ram's horn. And when they blew it, I wish I had one, when they blew it, you knew what was going on. They would blow it when kings came home from war. They would blow it when they were going out to war. They used it as a signal for things. And it was a sign of power to strike fear, right? Remember Braveheart? And all those guys in the kilts flipped them up and showed them what the deal was? It was to strike fear into their enemies. And I have a feeling it did a good job, okay? Strike fear. What? So when you go out into the battle, right? You have the upper hand. You have the upper hand. The first part of this is about God's power. And this is where I told you last week we're going to shift, because this series was built off of a premise, you are, I am. It's kind of a play in words that PJ put together about he is all of this, and because of that, I am this. And that's what we've been doing, and I haven't been using that play because of building it to the end right here, okay? We're coming to the last couple weeks of this series, and there's a point, and you're going to see how this thing comes around and how he's giving you all that you need to do what? To go out and to love a world around you. So the first side of this is his power. A couple weeks ago, we talked about God, so I'm not going to go back into all that stuff, but I want to give you a few that I didn't give you a couple weeks ago, because honestly, the list is infinite. It just keeps going about how amazing he is. So this is his kind of power. He's majestic. Exodus 15:6 says, your right hand, O Lord, glorious in power. Your right hand, O Lord, shatters your enemies. He's majestic. He's unlimited and infinite. That's hard for me to grasp. But his power is unlimited and infinite. And you may be sitting there, and this is why most people struggle when somebody says unlimited and infinite. You may be sitting there in the middle of pain or hurt or something like that that's going on in your life, and you're saying, I just need a little bit of that power. Need a little bit, right? Where is it, God? He's also wise with that power. He knows when it's right. The point is to bring us. Confrontation is for the purpose of redemption. The point is to bring us into a relationship with him. There's a bigger purpose than the little things that we deal with in life. So not only is he majestic and unlimited and infinite, he's also wise in heart and mighty. He's also wonder-working. These are things that we don't listen to or hear on a normal daily basis. But they're things we got to keep in mind when it comes to who he is. Because the right perspective, remember? The right perspective about who God is will change your life. It'll help you go beyond who you are and be the person that he's called you to be, because you have a plan. Each one of us has a plan. He's also redemptive. So those are all different ways amidst all the other that we talked about God's power. But now I want to talk about how he empowers you and me. That's what it gets down to, the rubber meets the road, right? Rubber meets the road when we start realizing how he empowers us to go forward and to do things. And to do that, I'm going to use a story, but I'm not going to read it to you. I'm just going to tell you where to find it. It's in Luke chapter 19. It starts in verse 1. And I want to encourage you, read it sometime. Don't just take my word for it. Open the book up and see what it says.
Come on.
There was a guy. He was rich, okay? I've never been rich. I don't completely understand that, but he was wealthy. He was a tax collector nonetheless. Now, I don't know about you, and I don't know if you are an IRS worker, but I've never been great friends with IRS workers. It's never seemed to work out in my favor, if you know what I'm saying. When it comes to IRS, they got it down. They got you pegged. And just like today, where most of you would say IRS workers aren't my best friend, tax collectors back then weren't the best friend of the people either. Because there was even less restrictions about what happened. And I'm going to tell you how he got his position. In the end, the way that he got his position was this. I'm going to borrow this. I don't know who put this money in here. I'll put it back. You guys can watch me. In the end, it was a bribe. He got his position by paying somebody off. And the reason that he did it was this. He collected taxes for the Roman government. But while he was in the middle of it, he could also pull a little bit for himself. So it wasn't just getting taxed. It was getting taxed unfairly. And knowing that the guy that was taxing you was taking a little cut. They weren't well liked, okay? Tax collectors were not well liked back then. Because everybody knew what was going on. I mean, it doesn't take much to say, hey, you're taxing me 100, okay, that's fine, and you watch him slip 20 in his pocket. Come on now. That doesn't make me very happy. I don't know about you. But he heard something. He heard something about a guy named Jesus. Now, I'm not a big Justin Bieber fan. And I'm not going to weigh in on his life, okay? Because I don't know the kid. But what I do know is he knew how to generate a following. And there was what I would consider hysteria around him. Where, yeah, the girls are all back there. Oh, yeah. I'm watching them nod. I'm like, oh, my gosh, this is going nowhere good. Okay, I only had one girl sing to me last week, okay? I didn't have hundreds out in front of me, all right? And we couldn't even understand completely what was going on. I couldn't anyway. I was like, at least she's singing to me. It's not like they were chanting, oh, Jeremy, woo, woo. When a following comes, right? When a group of people catch on and hysteria starts happening, you just kind of get swept into it. Now, I wasn't around. I was a little kid when the Beatles were around, but that was hysteria, right? It just, wherever they were, people right there, right? They went over there, everybody's there. They're playing a concert over there, everybody's there. What's happening is Jesus is moving, and before anybody else has had this crazy success with TV and all this other stuff, he's got a hysteria around him of people because they want to see what's going on. It's kind of like if you've ever been in that situation with some family members or friends and you're hanging out for dinner, and all of a sudden somebody's like, hey, I got something in between bites, and they start telling you about something that's going on. It makes you kind of, I want to see that. That'd be cool. The next thing you know, you're telling somebody else, and they're telling somebody, before long, everybody wants to know. And so this tax collector, he realized that Jesus was coming to town. Sign me up. Sign me up. And so as he came into Jericho, Jesus, the streets were lined, and everybody was looking just to get a glimpse, because they had heard the stories about the woman who reached out and just touched. Now, they didn't have television, and they didn't have radio, and they didn't have all that other stuff, but I guarantee you, when somebody gets healed and something crazy happens, word spread like wildfire across the land. She just touched, what? He could see. I know that guy. That guy couldn't even get up. He was crippled over there, and now he's standing. He's running and he's praising God. There was hysteria. And the streets were lined with people because they wanted to catch a glimpse. Now, we don't have that kind of hysteria because he's not walking the streets the way that he is. We have the Holy Spirit here now. But let me just tell you, if you got him into your heart in that way and you created a hysteria, what could happen would be unbelievable. It would be unbelievable. We lose sight of it because we don't have him coming through that door. We can't line up around him. We can't touch him the way that they did. But they had that, and there was hysteria. And this tax collector wanted to see what was going on. He wanted to see. Wanted to see Jesus. For nothing more. Because I cannot imagine that he ever in a million years thought that he was going to get to talk to him. Now, if I go to Justin Bieber concert, right? I'd look out of place, one. Okay. A bald-headed old guy chanting Justin Bieber does not do the same thing as a young teen girl, okay? It just doesn't do it. I'd be out of place. I won't. Don't worry. I'm not going to be there. You will not see that picture of me on Facebook. Selfie. Okay? You'll not see that. But the reality is, if I go there, I know I ain't talking to Justin Bieber, right? Me and him ain't jumping in the Ferrari afterwards and ripping down the 101 at 200 miles per hour. He might do that, but I'm not going to be in the car probably with him because he doesn't know me. The tax collector was the same way. He didn't have any realistic chance of talking to Jesus. He just wanted to see him. Just wanted to see him. But he was short. Problem. That's a problem. That's what the Bible says. That's it. The Bible says he was short. I'm going off of what it says, okay? They didn't have high-heeled shoes. Okay, now this is completely sidebar. I lived in L.A. for a little while. And thankfully, I am tall, okay? If you haven't figured that out, I'm fairly tall. I don't have to look up to too many people. When I was there, I saw a lot of short guys who are very famous. I'm not going to name names because this will make it around YouTube somewhere. And they all wore really, really tall high heel boots. I'm just saying. He didn't have high heel boots to wear, okay? He didn't have those. He was stuck at the back of the crowd not being able to see. So what does he do? He's smart. Tax collector. He paid the people off. He knows how to get the money. He ran down the street because he knew where Jesus was going, right? He ran down the street. They want you to sign in and put how much money you're going to put in the bucket. Okay, I just cleared that up. When it gets to you, okay? No. See, I get so sidetracked. I don't even know how PJ trusts me up here. I really don't.
Definitely a little more tame than myself.
He runs down the street and he climbs up in a tree just so he could catch a glimpse. So he could catch a glimpse of Jesus. And I imagine it kind of like this. He's up in the tree, and Jesus is walking along. He's got all of his people. Now, I've never been in the middle of a procession where you're kind of being like mobbed almost. Like, I've never been in the middle of that personally. But the way that I've always imagined it is it's just distracting. Like, I've been in the middle of some big games and different things like that where our team did really good and people are yelling and cheering. And when you're in the middle of it, you're just distracted with all the stuff. It's noise and people yelling. You're trying to listen to the coach. You got this going on. It's just distracting. And Jesus had his disciples with him, so they're hanging out. And I'm sure they're pulling on him, telling him to do this, go here, do this. And everybody else is trying to touch him and look at him and get his attention so that they could, what, hear from him. And as he's going, amidst all of this, he looks up and he sees our tax collector. And he says, "Come on down." I need to go to your house and we're going to have dinner. And the rumor spreads that Jesus is going to eat with a tax collector. Tax collector. Now you say, "Jeremy, that's a good story." It is a good story. You need to read it in Luke 19. You need to read it. Okay, I'm going to say it again. You need to read it. Actually, how many are going to read it? Good job. Most of you kept your hands down. Good job. You need to read it. Say, "Jeremy, how does a story about this guy tie in with the power that God gives us?" And that's where I'm going to piece it in right now. One of the ways that God gives us power is by guidance. He guides us. I don't know if you realize this or not, but our tax collector, I don't think he even knew the reason that he wanted to go see, other than just the mass hysteria around who Jesus was. But out of that hysteria, God guided him to the exact spot that he needed to. To be found by him. I've been in situations like that. Places where I didn't think that I should maybe be or even didn't want to be necessarily. But in the middle of it, God did something. You find yourself in the middle of a scenario where you're like, "This sucks and I don't want to be a part of it." But all of a sudden it starts bringing clarity. Starts bringing clarity from guidance. He took you in there, or allowed you to go in there, so that out of the middle of all of it, all of a sudden it all starts bringing clarity to your mind. It's a guidance that's beyond us. Beyond what you or I can control. I can tell you go down the street and go do this, but I can't guarantee that when you get down there, something good's going to happen in your life. When he guides us, we find ourselves in those moments where we're called out, and he brings you right to where you need to be. Amen. A guidance that we don't understand. He goes on through that and he empowers you by giving you deliverance. You see, our tax collector, when he got in the middle of the house, he realized what he'd been doing wasn't right. He said, "I'm going to give all that money back, and if I've cheated people, I'm going to give them four times more." Now, this isn't about the money. This isn't about all the stuff that he gave back. It isn't even about what he took. It's about his heart getting right with Jesus. Everybody looks at that and they look at the money. They look at, "Oh, we give it back." And they say, "Well, you know what? I've been in situations where I've wronged people or I've done this and I can't fix it." You know what? It isn't about all that stuff. It's about where your heart is. Come on. It's about what God's doing with you and how he's delivering you. And he wants to empower you to give that same deliverance that he wants to give you to other people. It's about being a witness. Believe, belong, become. Love God, love others, right?
Yeah.
That's the church's heart cry for Big House. And part of that is being a good witness for who He is. What is a witness? It's nothing more than somebody who testifies to the goodness of what's happened in your life. He wants you to do that. When our tax collector gave that money back, do you understand the kind of witness that was? It stunned people. That wasn't the way it worked back then. Everything was about bribery and about money. And all of a sudden, the guy who had all the power gave it back as a witness. He was pulling the strings like a puppeteer. And he let him go. Now that's a life-changing place to be. He changed it. But it's about more than just being a witness. He empowers us to go beyond that with wonders and signs. I prayed with two people this morning out here. You want to know what my prayer was? Oh, me of great faith, right? You want to know what my prayer is? God, help. You're the healer. You're the one that fixes things. I can't do it, and I want you to. I wish I could twist your arm, but I'm not in control. You get it. I don't. But you've empowered me to do wonders and signs, so I'm going to be faithful. I'm going to be faithful.
Yes.
You want to know what a wonder? You want to know what a wonder and sign is for Zacchaeus? He was called out in the middle of a place that I guarantee he did not think he was going to get called out in. And you can do the same thing, because you could be standing somewhere, or you could pull up at a stoplight on your bike, and the next thing you know, you could be used for wonders and signs, because you can help somebody.
Come on.
It's beyond that. Wonders and signs happen today. I've seen them happen, man. I've seen God do things. Why? And who gets it? I don't know. That isn't me. I'm not the judge of that. He's the one in control of it, but we need to be faithful, right? We need to engage as a people who follow Him. It's an interesting concept. The word Christian came, and I get sidetracked because things jump into my mind, okay? I'm just telling you how I speak, but that's just a little insight into me. The word Christian was more than just a name to classify a group of people. It signified people who followed after Jesus, who lived the way that He lived, who served people the way that He served people. It wasn't just a name. It wasn't a cross. When I was growing up, I thought being a Christian was nothing more than showing up, putting my butt in a seat at church, wearing a cross, and saying that that's who I was. But I realized it's bigger than that. Now, I'm just getting inundated and learning about the biker culture, but let me just tell you, I understand the 1%, and they're not the right percent. That isn't the percent that I want to be a part of. But when it comes to Christianity, I want to be a part of the 1%. And I hope that's what you want, too. Because I could call myself a Christian all day long. I can. When I can wear that cross, I took it off for a reason. Because I realized wearing a cross, and I'm not saying this to tell you what to do or what not to do. I'm just telling you what I needed to do. Because it's about your journey with God. I took it off because I realized that it was more than just wearing a cross. It was letting Him have His way with my days. Where all of a sudden I looked at situations that I don't like doing. I don't love going to the grocery store to pick up groceries for my wife. I do it because I like the benefits. I like my wife. I like her being happy. Right? I do it. This is what I love to do. But I tell you what, in the middle of those things, things that I don't necessarily love to do, I can find purpose.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, my life starts changing. It's about His kingdom. 1 Corinthians says this, the kingdom of God does not consist in talk, but in power. We could talk till we're blue in the face. We could say all the right things. I can have all the perfect things to say. But in the end, if you don't realize that what I'm saying is genuine, that I wasn't the first one at the altar when I wrote this message, that I wasn't saying, Lord, you got me here. It doesn't matter because it's just words. And when you leave here, you can tell your buddy or your friend about Christ, and it can be all about that. And you can recite this, and you can say, this is what the pastor said. But if you don't get to the point where he says, bottom line, this is how Christ impacted me, and you're not genuine with Him, it's not about the kingdom. It's about you just telling a story. We need to be the kind of people that live the life that this book talks about. He empowers our life. I like this verse, Ephesians. The immeasurable greatness of His power towards us who believe, according to the working of His great might. He gives you and me all the resources that we need. You may say, well, I don't have all that stuff. I can't talk. You know what? The reality is every time I come up to speak, it doesn't matter if I'm here or somewhere else, or even if I'm just talking one-on-one with somebody, I still get nervous. I get nervous every time. You may say, everybody's like, you don't get nervous. You know what? If you could feel my palms are sweating right now. I just am thankful that I don't have visible things where I'm just like, oh. Hey. Everybody, right? Worst fear is, one of the worst fears for most people is public speaking, right? And what? Death? I was going to say nudity. I was going to say, the worst would be me public speaking nude. I mean, that's the worst. Like, death. He took it. He took it to the death thing. I wasn't going to go there. Oh, man. Here we go. See, I get sidetracked. Yeah, now you know what it is. Preach on, preach on, preach on. He empowers us for physical healing. See, I haven't seen it. You want to know what the healing movement has done for Christianity? It's created a bunch of liars. Because we get wound up under the excitement of it. And we want it so bad. We want it so bad. And I don't think it's the wrong motive, but in the end, He either heals you or He doesn't heal you. And I'm not the judge of that. I'm not the giver of that. I'm the one that's called to lay hands on a brother or sister and to pray in faith fervently that God would do something unbelievable. But He does heal. I've seen Him heal. I've had it. I had, here's an interesting thing, and this wasn't in my notes either. You guys are getting all sorts of stuff today. I was working at a church up in Prescott Valley. Busy. We were busy. We're building a new building. And we're busy. Leading multiple ministries. I was involved with a lot of the building sides of things. I was dating my wife. We were dating at that point. Trying to win her heart. You know, that keeps you busy. was going to school full-time amidst all of that, distance education, doing stuff online, trying to become the best follower of Christ that I could become. And there was this guy, his name was Mac. I will never forget Mac. Mac and I spent a lot of time together. He would come in during the weeks and we would build things. We'd put up things where the speakers were. He's just a handy guy, just a good guy. We'd spend hours building and talking about God. It was just the coolest experience. So I have all this stuff going on. I'd just gone to a mission trip to Bangladesh. We were over there doing stuff with the poor and saw things I'd never seen and haven't seen since as far as deformity and craziness. When I got back, I had to fly from there to Dallas, and I drove back from Dallas. And when I got back, Mac died, and it hit me hard. It hit me real hard. So I was sitting at dinner with my then girlfriend, my now wife, and I'm going to say this. She's not going to like it so much, but I'm going to say it how I remember the story, okay? You can ask her side of it. It wasn't probably as mean as it's going to sound, but I remember sitting there, and I remember her saying, at least this is how I remember it anyway, said, "What's wrong with your face, Jeremy?" I don't know. That's a good question. I'm not looking at it. she wasn't that mean about it. She was just concerned. She said, "You should go in the mirror." I went in the mirror and I had Bell's palsy. Half my face had fallen. I just bought her a ring. She didn't know this. Wanted to ask her to marry me. And the only thing that was going through my mind is, how in the world am I going to ask her to marry me when I'm looking like this? I didn't know what to do. I went home. I just laid in bed. Started crying. And you can say, "Real guys don't cry." Well, I was crying, man. I'm like, my life, I didn't know what to do. I was lost. Like, I was in the middle of all these things. I thought I was doing all this great stuff for the Lord, and I found myself hurting. I thought, I won't ask Jamie to marry me like this. If I would have stayed like that, I probably wouldn't be married to her today. Because it's just where I was, right? 2 weeks later, it just all came back. I don't know why. I went from that place, we were there for another year, I went to Texas, I was out there for a season. Met a young guy out there. To this day, I still know him. I still see him on Facebook. Still has. He had just had Bell's palsy happen. Still has the consequences of Bell's palsy. I don't know. Sometimes I don't know why he heals some people and why he leaves other people. I don't get it. I don't get it. But I do believe that he's a healer. I do believe that he is the healer. But he not only is the healer, he empowers you and I to go out and to do something. To pray for people, to have faith for people, because sometimes they need you to have a little bit of faith for them. Amen. They need you to hope for them. Because in the middle of that bottom-out period, sometimes you don't have hope for yourself. And you need somebody to come in and to speak words of life over you again. He empowers us to prayer. I'm going to skip through some of these, but I want to give them to you so you see them. He empowers us to hope. He is our hope. He is the blessed hope, the one who is a hope above all other hopes. Because at the end of this, I know that I'm going to spend eternity with him. spend eternity with Him. He empowers us with endurance and patience. Sometimes endurance to make it through things. Sometimes patience to handle the situations that you're in. He empowers you in spiritual warfare. The best book that I can give you on that is to go back and read This Present Darkness or Piercing the Darkness. It's a great book that illustrates what spiritual warfare is going on around us. And it is going on around you. Whether you realize it or not, there is a battle that happens around us. And it's bigger. It's a cosmic level than what we... It's bigger than a war. It's bigger than anything that we realize because it's people's lives on the stake for all of eternity. He empowers us for works of faith. I'm going to read this to you out of Thessalonians. Flip past it. That's why I need to mark these things, but I never do. You should learn. You've got to learn your lessons, people. He empowers us for works of faith. It says, to this end, we always pray for you that our God may make you worthy of His calling and may fulfill every resolve for good and every work of faith by His power. It goes on in chapter 2. It says, comfort your hearts and establish them in every good work and word. We can go on to chapter 3 and it says, but the Lord is faithful. He will establish you and guard you against the evil one. We can go over to 2 Timothy 1:8 where it says, therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me as His prisoner. This is Paul. But share in suffering for the gospel. By the power of God. He empowers us. You want to know something? There are very few things that make me... I'm a pretty chill guy overall, but there are very few things that make me as angry as when I watch people behead my brothers and sisters. But I'm going to tell you something. They didn't just give their life in vain because Christianity is growing in the Middle East like crazy right now. Where there is suffering, the message of Christ grows at alarming rates. We don't understand that because we are not in a place where we suffer persecution for our faith. We don't get it because we're not there. But I guarantee you, although they did not want to die, I guarantee you when they bowed their knees and put their heads on that block, they knew where they were going at the end of the day. And they knew the result. Now, I'm not saying to you that they wanted to die. I don't think anybody wants to just die. That isn't the way that it is. But they knew that their testimony and their willingness to suffer would produce something much greater. Much greater than anything that they could comprehend or be involved in. And their names are still being sung over there within that community as people who endured and ran the good race. And they stood at the end of the line hearing, well done, thou good and faithful servant. That is not a message that we want to hear in America. I don't want to hear that message. I don't want to hear that my suffering could produce something. But let me just tell you, if I love Jesus the way that I'm called to love Him, there's a reality that may have me suffer. Second Timothy 4:11 says this. Luke is alone with me. This is Paul saying this. Get Mark and bring him with you. For he is very useful to me for ministry. You may not catch what's going on here, but there's a backstory to this that's very powerful. Because the next way that he empowers you is an empowerment for service. And that's when you get to the point where it's beyond believing, it's beyond belonging, it's at a point where you start becoming. Mark went out with Paul early on in a journey. It's Paul and Silas. And he got out there, and the intensity of the situation that they found themselves in caused him to back up. And he left. He left the trip. And so when Paul and Silas were getting ready to go on their next missionary journey, they're getting ready to get sent out to go out and to do some really cool things, Silas wanted to bring Mark along. He said, hey, that guy learned his lesson. Paul said, no. I ain't bringing that guy along. He bailed on us. No. We ain't bringing him along again. But in 2 Timothy, we find Paul coming back. This is years later. Years later. And some of you need to hear this because maybe you went along on the journey for a little bit and then you pulled back. Getting too intense. I'm pulling back. PJ wants me to serve. Wants me to shake hands. I don't do that. Wants me to speak. I really don't do that. Because I'm afraid of speaking in death, right? Speaking in death. I don't want to do that. Ooh. Here Paul is years later, and he says, bring Mark along because he's useful to me. And I don't know if anybody's ever spoken this over you, but you are useful. Amen. You are useful in the kingdom. I don't care what happened before. I don't care. It's today. My wife and I were just talking about that very concept this week. We were talking about things that had happened in the past that are easy to hold on to. Easy to hold on to. And I can't say that I've always had this much clarity about life, but for whatever reason, in the middle of that moment, I had this clarity. I realized that it doesn't matter anymore. It doesn't matter what my mom thinks. It doesn't matter what her mom thinks. It doesn't matter what anybody thinks at that point because I'm not living there anymore. And the reality is I can't go back and change the decisions that I made back then. I can't go back and fix the wording the way that I said things. All I can do is live right here, right now. And a lot of people lose out on the opportunity to let God show you power through service by living in the past, caught in something, a web of things. I have friends who still believe, and there's nothing wrong with telling stories of the good old days. I'm not saying that, but it's when you get caught in those things and you let them define you. You are useful. You are valuable. God has a plan for your life. Don't let what's happened before hold you back there. You can't fix it anyway.
Come on. That's right.
I have so many friends who are caught in that. I've been caught in that. Where I've let my past tell me how I'm going to live today. You can't change it. You can't fix it. We were talking, my wife and I were talking about, we wanted to go back and defend ourselves because somebody had a wrong view about a situation that happened. And I was sitting there over coffee and I said, you know what, it doesn't matter. Even though their opinion was completely wrong, changing their opinion now doesn't matter. I am who I am right now. Fixing that back then, spending my life worrying about that back then, leads nothing but keeping me chained and bondage to that stuff.
Come on.
It's time to let it go, friends. He's empowering you to become, to be a part of service for Him. And some of you are going to have to say, okay, I'm going to lay that down. I'm not going to worry about that anymore. Because those things are just going to hold you back from fulfilling everything that He has for you. Last point here. We're going to start wrapping this thing up. It'll only be like an hour-long wrap-up, okay? I'm out of here. I am too. What am I doing here? First Peter 1:5 says this, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. God empowers you for a life of godliness and for the ultimate, and that's in salvation, Him saving your life. He empowers you for that. Hebrews 4 says this, the Word of God is living and active. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It pierces down to the vision of soul and spirit, joint and marrow, and it discerns the thoughts that you have and the intentions of your heart. Romans 1:16 says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. I love You, O Lord. You are my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. My God, my rock, in whom I take refuge. My shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised. And I'm saved from my enemies. And I'm saved from my enemies. We all find ourselves in a spot like our tax collector. Now, you may not be wealthy, and you may not have bribed your way into the position that you find yourself in. But we're sitting at a place that's talking about Jesus. And you have an option like He did to go and seek Him out or to draw back. You see, our tax collector had that. He didn't have to go out. He didn't have to go out and pursue Jesus. He wanted to go out and pursue Jesus because he wanted to find out the truth and to know it for himself, not from what somebody told him about, not from something else that's going on in his life. He wanted to see it and to know it and to understand it for himself. And every one of us finds ourselves in that exact same spot. Are you going to go out and look for him? Are you going to go to the extreme of getting up in a tree so you can see past a crowd to where he has a chance to call you out? Because he wants to empower you. He wants to empower you for something so much greater. So much greater. So much greater. Father, I thank you for my brothers and sisters. I thank you for what you're doing in their hearts, because it's not about my words or about what I'm saying or even about me being here. It's about you moving in people's hearts and challenging them. I pray that they would find themselves in a state of hunger, wanting to know more about what Jesus has for them. The power that he wants to impart into them. The gifts that he wants to free in their hearts and their lives so that they can go forward and do something bigger than what they've been about. I pray today that they wouldn't be afraid to grab a hold of that and to climb that tree so that he could look up at them and say, come on down here, I want to come to your house. And when they get there, I pray that they would be bold enough to leave whatever it is that they're holding on right at the floor, because it's about their hearts with you, Lord. Empower them to be the people that you've called them to be. Now is the time, friends. Now is the time. Will you go seeking him out amidst the things that you're dealing with? Or are you going to pull back? Will you let the things of the past keep you wrapped up and chained down when all you need to do is say, it's time to let him go? It's time to let him go so I can be the person God's called me to be today. It is your choice. That is you. You're saying the Holy Spirit's doing something in my heart right now. It's time to stand up and to come down here. The team wants to pray with you. They want to encourage you. They want to help you through that process. They want to pray with you for the healing that you've been looking for. Will you join me?
Trying to share my journey a little bit with you on Facebook, and I do appreciate the fact that you guys have been real respectful of the understanding I'm on a sabbatical, so I don't get a bunch of private messages from you guys asking a bunch of questions. And the leadership of the church here is well able to handle anything and everything. Jeremy, as a pastor, he's been in ministry almost as long as I have. These guys, we've got a great team, but I want you to know I appreciate it, but I realized how hard it is to unplug in this world that we live in. How many understand that? We live in a tough world to unplug. And I've been a good pastor at taking my day off. But you know what I realized? I've done some studies on studies that were studies on unplugging. And the studies that were done on unplugging in the 90s are different than they are 2015. Does everybody understand what I'm saying? Because they did a study, and it was back in the 90s that I read, and it was sometimes, you know, God's stuff is backed up by what the world's. They showed that if you take your day off like God says, take your day off, that you really be more productive in the 6 days that you work. Now go figure. This was a world study showing God's. So, anyways, I'm learning to unplug myself, and so it's been good for me. And I want you to know, I appreciate it as your pastor. But I will tell you this. When I get back here on July 12th, y'all better have your running shoes on and your work boots out, because we're going to be kicking the devil's door down like never before, okay? So with that, I'm just going to, and I want to remind everybody as we close, you know, the buckets are up here, and this one I'm going to give us a little scripture. This is scripture God. I've probably shared it sometime within the last 8 years at Big House before, but I'm going to share it again. Proverbs 11:25. It says, a generous person will be enriched. Anybody ever, without the beginning of that scripture, just thought, man, I wish I was enriched. I wish God would just make my life a little more fruitful. I wish that things would just be a little richer around me. Not necessarily even money-wise, just, man, I just wish I was living the good life. He says a generous person will be enriched. And he says, the one who gives a drink of water, will he himself be refreshed. In other words, when we make the first move, then God says, hey, I got to take care of that, man. I got to follow my words. This guy's going to be enriched. They're going to be enriched. So as we close, the buckets are always up here. But today, let's all be even exceptionally generous. Let's choose to live a generous life, not just here today, but let's choose to be exceptionally generous. You know, and I always tell people, you know, I carry a check in my pocket. I don't hardly write checks for anything. Does anybody? Someone wants to write you a check, don't you kind of go like, yeah, what? Come on now, okay? But I carry a check in my pocket in case God wants me to be generous on Sunday mornings. Because when we just have plastic in our pocket, sometimes it's hard to be generous because you don't got nothing to drop in the bucket. You can't give your credit card. So I'm just saying, let's all make sure when we come on Sunday mornings that we're making provisions that we can be generous in the household of God when he speaks to our hearts. Amen? Because really and truthfully, this church is about what I said in announcements. We're about going out and finding those in this community that need a life-changing experience with Jesus and bringing it to them. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for a great word that Jeremy brought to us today, God. Thank you for the love and the refreshment that I feel just being here in Big House, Lord. And I know that that's what people feel when we come here together, and that's why we keep coming here together, Lord God. Lord, we ask as we're generous this morning, God, as we give in this offering to refresh our community and refresh others, God, that we ourselves will be refreshed, God. Lord, and I thank you that your word says you'll do that, God, that you'll enrich our lives, you'll refresh us, Lord. We love you, we love you, we love you. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. Amen. Give Jesus a great big hand.